Just online.
It'll go online. Sweet. It'll be there forever haunting you. Unlike Vivian Maier, people will know exactly who you are for the rest of your life. Because all they have to do is click on YouTube and there you will be. Assuming YouTube is there forever.
That's already too late for me.
Never go away.
It's already over. Do you feel overexposed? Are you...
Sometimes. You know. But
did you want to be a celebrity? Did you have any...
Oh, I'm not a celebrity. No, I'm not a celebrity. No, but you know what? I mean, I didn't... I could never have imagined that... you know, right when it first started going around online, when I put on Flickr, that it would become so popular. And, you know, I mean, there's so much press writing about it that I have nothing to do with. And everyone thinks that I'm, like, doing that. So it's interesting, you know. It just has a life of its own.
It is unusual to be making a film, I mean, just the film part of it, to be making a film and not be able to control how the story gets out there. I mean, normally, you know, you have this great idea for a movie and you start to make the movie and you control when the movie gets publicity. Mm-hmm. I mean, you introduce the story to the world. This is one of those weird cases where because John was interested in having Vivian's work recognized, and the story is so much a part of that, we couldn't really control people writing about the story. It just took on a life of its own, and you know, people just keep discovering the story. So it's been a moving target. It started out as a discovery of a completely unknown artist, but now Vivian is known, you know, to many people, and so by the time the film comes out now, people will know the story, but they won't know.
Well, there's a lot of questions too.
Yeah, people have all these questions because we've uncovered.
The press did some coverage on it, and they have bits and pieces here and there. But of course, I'm not gonna give away our whole film that we've been working so hard on and give them all of our subjects. So we were, you know, of course, keeping as much to the film as we can. So because of that, there was a lot of questions that the press couldn't answer and stuff. So we answered the film.
Are you given to spending years of your life on something unexpected and just diving in and sticking with it for this kind of length? Or is this something completely...
I didn't know. It just happened. I didn't plan on doing this, of course. Is that what you're asking?
Well, but you have such commitment to it. I mean,
well, of course.
Interesting. It really seems to have become a big part of your life. And it's not only, you know, it's not 6 months, it's not a year, it's not 2 years.
It's like several years. I mean, I bought it 7 years ago, the first box. Mm-hmm. You know, if it wasn't that I was so curious and also that the work was validated by the world, I probably wouldn't have gone this far, you know. But because, you know, my hunch that this was good work is validated by the world, and her story and her, you know, the mystery is so intriguing to me and everyone else, obviously. That's what kept me and Charlie, you know, obsessed with this.
Yeah, but John won't necessarily toot his own horn, but I can toot it for him. I don't think there are too many people out there who would have stuck with this project the way that John is. I'm not talking about the film. I'm talking about the work of getting Vivian's name out there, showing her work to the world, curating it. Really, I mean, that's an incredible responsibility. He discovered an unknown artist and had to just make decisions about how she would be introduced to the world, specifically what images would be chosen to represent Vivian as a photographer. And he recognized that he's not an expert. So he went and he consulted with the experts. First, he went to institutions like Tate Modern and MoMA. They weren't interested in helping either financially or with the sort of, you know, all of the labor involved in exposing her work and figuring out how to present it. So he did the next best thing. He went to expert street photographers and critics and gallery representatives who could help him with the project. He mounted a show on his own at the Chicago Cultural Center, and the response was overwhelming. But he has continued. It was completely speculative. There was certainly no guarantee that it would get the response that it had. It was just a gut instinct he had that it was good work. And I think just most other people in that situation, I think would just sell it off or something. Mm-hmm. Just
which they did,
which people did, and so yeah, I just think it's an incredible thing that he happened to be the one to find it willing to do the hard work and obviously expensive work in getting her work seen.
So it's interesting to me that you were in the you were doing your own work, and now Vivian's work has become your work in a way. I mean, are you competitive in a weird way?
I was doing my own work. What work are you talking about?
Well, you were talking in the beginning of the picture. You were talking about you were working on a project and you were looking for images of Chicago.
Oh, I finished that before I even got involved in this.
Right.
So the book that I was working on, I completely finished. Right. And then I pulled out her box and I started scanning it.
So but if you hadn't found Vivian's work, you would have been doing some other.
Oh, I'm sure. I mean, I have a lot of weird projects that I work on that I just like go on these weird angles and I don't know. So I would have been working on something. I don't know what.
John, he's a bit of a dabbler and very enterprising in doing that. And he just seems like he's always figured out ways of, supporting himself as a real estate agent, as a sometime author, has like, side business
of selling cameras and eBay stuff, whatever.
So has that gone on through all of this?
Yeah.
7 years?
Well, not in real estate. I stopped real estate, officially in 2009, but I probably stopped selling homes in like 2008 or something. Mm-hmm. I buy and sell cameras on the side, not like aggressively, but mm-hmm. I go to estate sales a lot, so if I see something I could sell, I'll buy it and sell it.
So you just you're just diving into life, looking for something interesting all the time. It sounds like.
Sure.
I don't want to overstate it or make it.
I don't want to overstate it either.
Narrative.
It's not really that big of a deal to me because it's like I don't have a job. Mm. You know what I mean? I don't have I don't punch in or go to work for somebody. So
I don't want a job.
I know. I never want one.
Okay.
No, I seriously don't. If I don't have to, I have a way of keeping busy, probably more so than if I had a job. Anyway, I don't know where I'm going.
No, I think that's the answer to the question I was looking for is, your basic take on how you, somebody can spend 7 years of their lives.
Well, this was something else. This was a different thing because this was, once I realized how important this collection of work was, I had such a huge responsibility to make sure I did the right thing. And I took a lot of me educating myself on photography, people helping me, and getting as much expert advice as I can, and to try to do this the right way from the beginning. Mm-hmm. And it was a lot of work.
And
it still is.
I think if you knew, and maybe if he knew at the very beginning that this would be a 7-year project instead mm-hmm. of a couple year project, he might not have approached it with the zeal that he did. Might have thought, no, I don't want to do this for the next 7 years of my life. I don't want this to take over my life. But of course, you don't get to see into the future. And so little by little, he became more sort of obsessive about doing the work. And, then suddenly you look up and it's 7 years into the future. Same thing goes for the movie. I mean, no one, you don't necessarily go into making a documentary thinking this is going to take 4 years or 3 years. You hope it'll take less, but they somehow, manage to take longer than you think.
So how did you know when it was over?
That's the
thing.
Well,
had a deadline, which was a blessing of the Toronto Film Fest coming our way. We had a deadline.
Yeah.
We had to finish it.
I mean, that's the filmmaking cliche, I guess, is that, films are never completed, they're only abandoned. we knew that we wanted the film to be in a festival, mm-hmm. and like the project of figuring out who Vivian was and exploring her life, and going sifting through the mountains of evidence that John had accumulated, mm-hmm. You don't know when you're done. You don't know whether you have to exhaust every single piece of paper, every receipt, every business card, every envelope, every slip of paper that she managed to collect and hoard, really, mm-hmm. over her lifetime, whether everything has to be scrutinized before you can say you're done. And every last phone number is called, and every person who met her. That's the kind of stuff that kept us up at night. You know, is there one other clue that's going to somehow reveal it all?
If you go this far, you're like, you have to now finish it. Because if you've spent so much time and you're like, there's like this much stuff that are kind of like leads that you could continue to follow up on. Because they sometimes leads just like spider web out, and then you have all these, you know, various places to go from there.
Yeah, and sometimes they're evidence. There's evidence that leads to something great, and sometimes it's evidence of absolutely nothing at all, and it's maddening. I mean, you know, when detectives are trying to solve a crime, it's clear what the goal is. Mm-hmm. It's a little less clear when you're looking at evidence and trying to make a movie about someone. The evidence doesn't tell you what the finished product is.
Right.
So, you know, it's not like we weren't looking for a missing plane.
For me, it was finding Who's Drugs in Evanston, which I used to love. I went to Northwestern and it's been gone for many years now. But it's like my memory, how I remember Evanston. And so when the receipt for Who's Drugs comes up, I'm like,
that's funny.
Oh my God, that's my childhood.
That's great.
20-something years ago.
Yeah.
So how did you two get together in this?
Well, like I said, there was press kind of early on. And one of the things kind of had a successful life online, if you will. It had like 500,000 hits. And Jeff Garland ended up seeing it. Jeff Garland is a photographer, and he really took to the story. He contacted me, said he wants to be involved. So he became a producer. And I said, hey, I'm going to need some more help. The person I was working on the film with before is no longer on the project. And he went to Michael Moore, his friend, and asked for some suggestions. And he suggested Charlie. So Jeff says, I knew Charlie. And so Charlie worked with Michael Moore. But that's how, and then so we hooked up and then hit it off with ideas on how we're going to tell the story. And
Did you know Jeff, or did you just met him and?
I knew Jeff. We were both. I'm from Chicago as well. John obviously is from Chicago, and so is Jeff. So we sort of knew each other through Second City circles, more through comedy than photography or documentaries, and Democratic politics and that kind of thing. So I had known Jeff and his wife and stuff. But Michael was really, he was my mentor, and he was the one who, he's gotten me many of my jobs.
So did it feel like a job, or did it feel like you guys were getting to a marriage?
Both. Well, yeah, I mean, talking several times a day, every day for several years. My first reaction was I'd heard the story before, and it was one of those things where like, oh, of course that's a documentary. Why didn't I think of that at the time that I first heard the story? And then the fact that John had already begun interviewing some of the people that he had tracked down, some of the kids who she had been a nanny for, some of the families, and I started to talk to John, and he told me things like, hey, we discovered that Phil Donahue employed Vivian as a nanny. We shot an interview with her. And so I said, oh, I got to see that footage. Mm-hmm. So John had already started the work of shooting the film. That was exciting. The fact that she had hours and hours of Super 8 footage that she had shot, that she had all these audio tapes essentially in the machine radio documentaries that Vivian was making, where she would go and interview people about, the Nixon impeachment, or celebrities, that was, all of that was just incredible. I mean, to have that material, and obviously, over 100,000 photographs to choose from to illustrate not only her art, but also just from a documentary perspective, that when someone told a story about how Vivian used to take them to the to Skid Row in Chicago, or to the Stockyards as kids, we actually had not only photographs of it, but in some cases we had Super 8 film that she had shot, and so that was incredible. And I said, yeah, I have to be a part of this.
It is one of the things that's particularly unique about this film is that you have the the murder mystery, which is not a murder mystery, but the mystery of Vivian combined with this kind of culling of this material, which are usually two different documentaries. And they've mixed beautifully in this one. It kind of keeps it going to the end.
Yeah, I mean, there are a bunch of sort of narrative, you know, threads that had to be kept straight. The kind of the detective work, which is really, that's led by John. If you're going to have a detective story, you kind of need a detective. And John was actually, you know, sifting through the material, kind of an archaeological dig. So we went with the imagery of him laying out all of the material grid-like, as if it, as if there was this very systematic, you know, effort to like lay out her life. I think the truth is it was a little more haphazard than that. I mean, there were piles of things and they had to be, you know, sifted through. But the main story obviously is, you know, who was this person, who was, you know, Vivian. It's really Vivian's story, and we're trying to tell the story of an artist who masqueraded as a nanny. And why? Why did she lead this double life? And why did she keep that other identity, the artist side of her life, so secret?
So in a situation like that, where you're doing that story, normally you would have a bunch of interviews sitting on the cutting room floor. Are there a bunch of interviews in this case sitting on the cutting room floor?
Well, there was 90 people that were found that knew her.
Mm-hmm.
And that was all, you know, documented and like arranged and called, and will you do an interview? Yes, sure, whatever. But I always ask for their stories. You know, what do they remember? What's their angle? Most of them, you know, out of that 90, there's a lot of them that overlap the same thing, or it wasn't really that important.
Mm.
And then half of them were actually interviewed. So about 40-something people were interviewed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and these were interviews that were 1 hour to 4 or 5 hours, you know. And then, you know, so we only have maybe a dozen or so, I don't know, in the film. So there's a lot of them that didn't make it, yeah, for sure.
One of the great curiosities to me at the end of the film was why, whether Phil Donahue was asked, and just because it wouldn't have fit at that part of the film, it could have had, would have had to hold it, but why she left. Because he, when he talks about her, he talks about, I mean, it kind of like sets up the mystery in a way. That
oh, you know what?
She left so quickly.
One of the reasons I think is the kids didn't really get along with her.
Mm.
Yeah, the kids didn't really like her that much. And they were also getting older. They didn't really need a nanny.
Which
I don't know what it
becomes
was
part of the
exactly.
story later on. That she had some issues with how she handled the kids in some cases.
Right, but it wasn't because I, you know, we talked to the kids. It wasn't because of anything like abuse or anything like that. It was, you know, she would, for example, she would cook, you know, fish with the head on it, you know, and the eyes are in it and everything, and they're just like freaked out by this, or, you know, squid that are all like together with the head and everything. And so,
I have a 4-year-old who says he doesn't want the fish looking at him.
Yeah, so, well, Phil Donahue said, like, you know, when she walked away, one of them put the squid in his pocket and said he ate it, and he threw it out later because this was just such a strange. And also, she would make, I just remember this. Many of the families that she worked for, she had the tradition of the first meal she cooked was a cow tongue. Just a big, meaty, glistening cow tongue. And it was almost like, this is who I am, and this is, like, get ready, you know?
She's making her artistic statement right up front.
Yep.
Well, that's brutal.
So, I mean, you know, this is, you know, his kids probably, and also he said they were getting old, so I don't know what it was, But it wasn't anything like, you know, some of the other children experienced.
And were there people who didn't want to talk about her, or was that really not
there? Everybody wanted to talk about it. We had a couple interviews that we did with the family that she nannied for in Chicago for, you know, over maybe like a dozen years. And after they saw her becoming popular in the press, they're like, you know, John, you know, we like everything you're doing and we'll help you, we'll support you. We like everything that's going on with her, but she was like a mother to us. And we don't know if we feel comfortable, you know, going on camera talking about her. So if you don't mind not using it.
Yeah, so they ultimately elected not to be part of the film.
But almost because they were too close to her. It
wasn't
like
exactly.
People were saying something negative.
They even after she's gone, they still felt her, you know, kind of power of like, don't, you know.
I think they wanted to respect her privacy, and she was a very private person, and it was their instinct that she probably would not have wanted to be the subject of a film.
Exactly, yeah.
So was there any of that for you guys?
Oh, certainly. I mean, it's something that we wrestled with, but I would say, you know, we made our peace with it relatively early on. I mean, Vivian is now a famous artist. People want to know about the people that do great works of art. So people were already asking those questions. Her story was going to be told, and we thought that if it was going to be told by anyone, it should be told by us, and by John in particular, that it really had done all of the work in understanding who the person was. Obviously, we want to do it in a respectful way. We don't think that just because Vivian is interesting as an artist, and interesting because of the sort of double life that she led, and really heroic to us in that she made incredible sacrifices to do her art. I think being a nanny was obviously a means to an end. In some cases, literally, she would take the kids on these, you know, expeditions to the rougher parts of town in order to shoot her photographs. Sure, it was, you know, also to expose them to a different side of life, and you can look at it that way, and they're better for it, I would imagine, in many cases. Maybe slightly scarred in some cases by some of the things they saw. But we thought that Vivian's story was really heroic and should be and should be told in that way and respectfully. And just because parts of that story are interesting doesn't mean that you have to investigate every little corner of her life. And so there are some people out there who want to know absolutely everything about Vivian as if, you know, she's Teddy Roosevelt and we should be writing her biography. I don't know that we really feel that way. I mean, we felt that we should respect her sense of privacy up to a point and that if anyone was going to tell her story, we should tell it in a respectful way and artfully, really. We didn't want to tell a boring biopic.
I mean, there is an element of it where she is a bit like a nun or a monk, and their sexuality is not really an issue in the movie. And it not whether homo or hetero, but just none. It's like the question of whether she gave up her, you know, any of hope of that for her work seems to be part of the subtext, mostly.
I think so. I mean, I think that was something that we thought about and whether to try to address that.
You mean what her
sexuality? Whether to try to address that, but that seemed to us to kind of fall into that category of an area of her privacy that we wanted to respect.
But also, you know, we didn't have anything that came out that we could really say anything about.
Right.
Right. There was no Sam the Butcher down the street.
There was nothing at all. I mean, you know, some people say they think she's lesbian, but, you know, some of the families that we've interviewed that we didn't include their stories of say things that are not that important to the film, but we can kind of get an idea of who she was in that regard, whereas, you know, she's talking about if a man is attractive or not, or, you know, this or that. So we just got the feeling that maybe she's asexual, but we don't know, you know.
No, it's an interesting, I mean, because the travel, I mean, there's so many surprises through the movie, and then she goes off on this journey, this long journey, and you're kind of like, you know.
Well, there's many trips that she made.
Yes.
This is the longest one.
But her taste for the exotic and her taste for the, you know, adventurous kind of goes against that, and yet there's no indication of, I'm not saying you should have put it in when it wasn't there, but it's a fascinating twist in, you know, the idea of who she might be.
Yeah. Yes. I mean, she was a private person in terms of, you know, keeping certain details about her life to herself. But she was not an introvert. I mean, Vivian was not a wallflower. She wasn't someone who, you know, was overlooked. Right. The opposite. I mean, she made an impact on people when she met them. She was witty and she had a great sense of humor. She was incredibly opinionated, you know, about politics and about how kids should be raised and that sort of thing. I mean, she had, you know, about which city is better, New York versus Chicago. And, you know, she was very cosmopolitan in that sense. And she was chatty. I mean, she engaged with people and who she liked. and would have conversations. If she didn't like someone, she didn't give them the time of day. Mm-hmm. But so
well, even interviewing people in the streets and all that was, you know, it's pretty gutsy.
Yeah.
Not, you know, that's not a wallflower activity.
Oh, she was, yeah, she was fearless. Yeah. And so, yeah, but traveling around the world by herself as a woman in that, and during that time and the countries that she went to, I mean, all
but
over
she
South
went to
America.
Places also, like, she more than once went to Native American tribes, or I don't know if it's reservations or whatever, in Nevada, and then also in, like, Canada, like Churchill, Manitoba, and all these places in Canada, and she's staying with these tribes. I mean, she was kind of like an adventurer, explorer. I don't know what you want to...
So do you guys feel like you know her as much as one can? I mean, it's...
Yeah, as much as one can, for sure.
It's a weird tragedy.
I mean, I don't think there's any more that we could do, you know, to find out more about her. I mean, because, you know, literally all of her stuff, all of her phone books, mail, photos, you know, were combed through.
It's kind of the weird tragedy of the movie that, it, you know, you don't really even know who she is until she's dead.
Yeah, totally.
In that first moments of the film.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, but the people who knew her during her lifetime, even for very short periods of time, just people she met, you know, in passing once, some of whom are included in the film, they you know, remember her clearly. I mean, they remember everything that happened during their interaction with them, and so she had an impact on anyone she met.
All 7 feet of her.
Right.
Sorry.
Yeah, I think the real tragedy in her lifetime wasn't that she wasn't known to people, because I think she did really have an impact on them. I think maybe, and she didn't really want to be known as an artist. I think the real tragedy is that she didn't get to see that her work would eventually have such an incredible impact on the world, and that it would resonate so deeply with people. I think even if she would not have been comfortable with fame or recognition or didn't need the money particularly that might come from that, and you know, who knows if she would have profited from it had she, you know, gotten her work out there during her lifetime. But I think the real tragedy is that she just didn't get to see that that people would be moved by it. That I think she would have appreciated.
Mm. It's interesting. You have like somebody like Georgia O'Keeffe, you can kind of imagine her doing that, and then you can't imagine this woman actually going to the middle of nowhere and hiding out. I mean, like, she was so of the world, and yet so disconnected in a certain way. I guess what makes
the film fascinating. I think that the reason why she liked to travel was probably because she was just interested in different cultures, strictly, and she also liked to photograph them. But I mean, she was extremely intelligent. She left behind thousands of books on every range of topics you can imagine. She clipped all different types of newspaper articles, so you see her interests. What she photographs, especially her later work, it gets more politically and socially aware. And so it makes sense. Yeah, she's probably traveling because she wants to see the world. She's completely independent. She doesn't have to bring any kids along or nothing.
So did you guys ever disagree on big choices on this thing? Or?
Not really big choices. We disagreed on some things, but it was, you know...
I think we would always... I mean, if we did have little disagreements about tone or how much of something to include,
right.
And I think we always approached it with the spirit of, like, we're in this together, we're making one film, and it's not about who... It's about may the best sort of best idea win. And so the way we got to, let's say, some of the darker stuff that's included in the film, how much of some of the darker stories, darker material to include, or whether to include it at all, everything was on the table. We always would hash out, you know, how much of this part of the story to tell, how much of, you know, there's the suggestion of some abusive behavior in the film on you know, that Vivian...
Yeah, we'd have our editors weigh in too. You know,
yeah, and so it was always a conversation, you know, maybe that's partly why the film took as long to make as it did, is, you know, you're deciding what to include, what not to include, how much of it to include, where to put it in
where
the
to
film.
Put it. Yeah.
How, you know, obviously, if you're going to learn these dark things about Vivian, you want the audience to care about her. before you learn that. Mm-hmm. So, you know, those were the kinds of conversations that we had. I don't think there were any major disagreements.
So ultimately, you found the same voice.
We hit, you know, our ideas were, from the first time we talked about the film, were like spot on how we're going to do this. And we're both open-minded to, you know, somebody's reason why they disagree and would weigh it all in. I mean, it's not like, you know, somebody has like a mission to say it in a certain way. In fact, I was, you know, the dark stuff, it affects her image to people. Mm-hmm. And so if anybody should disagree with that, it would have been me, but I was more forthcoming to say, hey, whatever it takes to tell the right story, let's do it. I don't care if it affects how people look at her work, because this is important to tell it the most honest way possible and transparently.
Yeah. I mean, that many conversations about that. I mean, obviously, you know, there's a way of looking at the darker material and say, mm-hmm. you know, that John has a direct interest, or the gallery owners who are representing her work have an interest in presenting Vivian in the most positive light possible. But we understood from the start, maybe without even really saying it, that, you know, we were not going to sugarcoat mm-hmm. the story. We weren't going to we were going to present an honest portrait, an honest image of Vivian, and at the same time not go too far and give too much emphasis right. to some of the darker stuff, because ultimately I think it is a part of the story, but a small part, a very small part, and, you know, doesn't overshadow either her work, certainly, mm-hmm. or the you know, the many, many more wonderful stories that people told. Certainly she was eccentric and they told stories about that. And, mm-hmm. But I mean, I think if I had to describe how people remember Vivian, I would say they remember her fondly, even some of the, you know, the crazier stuff, you mm-hmm. know, Vivian clicking pictures of someone,
the
kid on the ground after after he's on his bike getting hit by a car, and there's Vivian taking pictures of it. I mean, they have a sense of humor about it, and they, you know, mm-hmm. they find it funny. And I mean, obviously the child wasn't seriously hurt, and right. that's why she was doing it. So yeah, I would say that people in general remember her fondly. And, you know, those were the sorts of things we talked about, was tone-wise, how much of one thing to include versus another. I think our biggest disagreement was at the very end, which was what font to use for the for the poster. That was probably our biggest.
That's a tough one.
Yeah.
That can be the biggest fight of all. You're
John
right.
won that one.
So are either of you done? Do you feel like it's now?
The film is finished.
The film is finished.
Of course.
But I mean, does this mean, Charlie, that you go off and you're done with Vivian ultimately, or?
Well, I don't think either of us is done with Vivian. We'll never be done. I mean, John certainly is not. His work, you know, continues with her archive.
I mean, we're attached to the film, you know, so.
Right.
So there's,
we have to make sure the film gets to be seen as widely as possible.
But I mean, I guess there is for you for sure, a bigger thing beyond the film that is kind of like this is part of a bigger picture that will go on for you for many years to come?
I don't think so. I think the archive itself, mm-hmm. that's separate.
Right.
So yeah, it'll help people understand her work better. And I think maybe, if this is what you're trying to say, I don't know, maybe institutions will get aware more of her work through the film and people mm-hmm. talking about it, and offer me some advice on what to do with it, or maybe I could find a new home for the archive.
But for you personally, Vivian will be an ongoing part of your life for,
I mean,
ever, really.
It is now.
Yeah.
It is, at least for the next coming months, you know. I mean, I have no idea.
John's in denial about the fact that, yes,
I want to have a life again. No.
Working on this.
I want to have a life again. I mean, I'm not going to do anything that, you know, I'm emotionally attached to Vivian's work. Mm-hmm. So I won't let anything happen to this work that is going to harm her reputation or her work, because, you know, it took me so long to get to the point where I knew what work to put out, because I was looking at a lot of her work. I mean, I could have put out anything. Mm-hmm. And I have a huge responsibility to make sure it's taken care of. Now, I'm one person, and it's a lot for one person to deal with. So, of course, I'm hoping that'll change.
Yeah, I think that's some of the unfinished business in the film as well, is that, you know, while Vivian's work has resonated with the public and galleries have, you know, taken on her work, institutions, cultural institutions, museums, mm-hmm. Critics, but in particular the, you know, museums that have the resources to do more with Vivian's body of work than John can do by himself. Obviously, he did all of the work, the initial work of getting it mm-hmm. printed and housing it and archiving it. But, you know, the cultural gatekeeping function that museums and institutions, art institutions play, I think we feel like there's unfinished business in that sense. And it's understandable that those institutions are slower to make a new artist, an undiscovered
totally.
Artist, yeah. part of the canon.
And it's expected to happen that way, because you can't just approach a museum and say, look at this great art, you should take it right now.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
But we certainly hope over time that her work will be acknowledged by those institutions.
Absolutely.